everyone. Welcome to another edition of Pittsburgh Sportsline. Thank you for watching. We have another great show for you. But I do have to tell you that Mike isn't doing well today, and he may even be in the hospital. So our prayers go out to Mike and any of his YouTube fans and all that. Try to contact him and keep him in your prayers. And we'll go on with the show here. We have a lot of great sports to talk about. And we're going to kick it off with Smokin' Jim. What's on your mind?
Hey, thanks, Al. First of all, I want to tell you again, thank you. I hosted a Super Bowl party Sunday in God's country, Monroeville, and my co-host was Al Levine, the Talking Machine, and it was just a great day. And I tell you what, every single person in the facilities knew about his dad, so that was a great thing.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Bill Neal was just super when he said, I dedicate this to your dad, Tiptoe. So anybody watching on YouTube or whatever, that was quite a tribute. I had a great time. And thanks for the invite. It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
What's on my mind is the Pittsburgh Steelers may have hired offensive coordinator / future head coach of the franchise. I let people know over the years that Art Rooney II, who wants to be the next Jerry Jones or Al Davis, he is not a Mike Tomlin man. If everybody remembers back, Art Rooney II offered the job to Russ Grimm, but his dad, Dan, who is now the ambassador of Ireland, stepped in and vetoed that. So Art Rooney II has never been a Mike Tomlin guy. Mike Tomlin had nothing to do with this hire. You got to realize, Haley is as close to the family as any of his kids or grandkids. Dick Haley was the former general manager of the Pittsburgh Steelers for 20 years, built 4 Super Bowl championship teams. Yeah. His son was the ball boy, and Todd Haley still dresses like a ball boy at times, rough and gruff, but he's an in-your-face type coach. He's a young guy. And I tell you what, I would not be surprised in a couple of years if you see Todd Haley elevated to head coach of Pittsburgh Steelers.
Jim, you always come up with some great insights here, and we'll talk about some of those subjects, I'm sure, later on, especially with me and Chip here. You know you're going to have a battle on some of that. But now I got to ask Chip Hayner, what's on your mind, buddy?
Well, what's on my mind is last week during Super Bowl week, there was the was brought up about the lawsuit that's being filed by the ex-players of the NFL, and it was headlined by Tony Dorsett coming out and saying that, you know, they were treated unfairly by management. During the years that they played football, they were forced to play injured. And I find this kind of unique that now, 30, 35 years, 40 years after they've played, now that they're suffering debilitating injuries, that they're trying to blame it on the management of the NFL and the teams in general, when, you know, football is a violent game, and it has always been a violent game. And, you know, these gentlemen that play football get compensated very well for it. And, you know, they choose to play this game. They know that there are inherent risks in playing the game that they're playing, okay? So, they, you know, they are compensated for it, and this is not a kind of a sport where you're going to, you know, have longevity and not walk away without some kind of lingering effects. And I really am interested to see how this lawsuit plays out because, you know, I really think they're barking up the wrong tree. I mean, at any time, they could have chosen to walk away. You know, they said that, you know, you got hit and you were dizzy and they told you to get back out onto the field. Well, you could have chosen not to go out on the field. And for that matter, you could have chosen to take another path in life if you wanted to. You would not have been able to be compensated as well or have the, you know, the style of life that they had. But, you know, they took the short-term rewards, you know, so, you know, but they weren't thinking long-term. Now that they're in their 40s, 50s, 60s, and they're having trouble, you know, all different kinds of trouble, I just find it kind of unusual that they would now want to come back and say, well, you know, I was treated unfairly. I personally don't think they were. It'll be interesting to see how the lawsuit progresses.
Chip, you always have something interesting to say, so we'll be back on a couple of those things. I have a few things on my mind, like usual. One of them is the Pitt basketball program, four in a row right now, and all of a sudden people are jumping on that bandwagon. They're even saying Jamie Dixon might be coaching his best season ever there, Smokin' Jim. So who knows what's happening? And I heard Pete Peterson on the radio there, and they said how they're getting out of the Big East and they're not going to sue the Big East like West Virginia. And, you know, he was talking about the Super Bowl with, what is it, the running back Heisnewski, or I can't pronounce his name, but look at how he was here. Great hard-nosed ball player playing a running game, and he can catch a few passes, and he got a Super Bowl ring. I mean, that's fantastic. So it does show that you can do that. And then look, a couple Hall of Famers from Pitt. Dolman and Curtis Martin, one of the greatest running backs to come around, who never even played football till his senior year at Taylor Alderdice, just to stay out of trouble. And what a nice guy when you meet him, when you hear him talk, just first class all the way. So, I mean, those are some good things. You know, I like to try to bring something out here that's a little positive with all the things we have, because we'll get into some of this coaching controversy at, you know, the Steelers and elsewhere, I'm sure.
But when you were talking about Pitt, do you think now with a four-game winning streak, are they NCAA-bound or NIT-bound? What do you think?
NIT first, and it depends on how many more they can win.
Well, you know, and I would say that they are headed in the direction to be NCAA eligible. They are not there yet, okay? They are showing what they have the potential to be. But you know what? Let's see what they do against South Florida tomorrow. You know, they've been playing real well. And as a matter of fact, that Villanova game, they got down near the end of it, and that scared me. You know, Trey Woodall played an amazing game, and, you know, he carried the team that day. But, you know, they got the work cut out for them. They're not tournament eligible yet, but they could be.
They didn't earn it yet, I'll tell you that much. You know, I'm a Pitt fan, but you have to earn that. And they're not there yet, and you do have a lot more games on the schedule here to go.
Well, their schedule's set up for them to be in a position where they could potentially win out, maybe lose one, possibly two games. But, you know, they still got to play them, and they still got to play, you know, 40 minutes of basketball.
Well, I tell you what, I would really, really love to see Pitt go on to the NIT. But speaking of basketball, one last thing is my favorite basketball player of all time was Pistol Pete Maravich.
Ooh.
On this day in 1970, Pistol Pete Maravich set an NCAA record with 69 points. He scored 47 points in the second half, and they lost. LSU lost to Alabama 104-102. And to me, you're looking at no shot clock, because many of the games, Pistol Pete, they just held the ball on him, and there was no three-point shot.
Think about
and
that.
He still averaged 44 points a game, you know, during the senior year.
And I don't think we'll ever see a player do that again, not in the way the game's played today. I mean, that's just an amazing statistic when you think about that. He did that for his career.
Well, look how
it just speaks for itself.
Another Western Pennsylvania guy.
That's right.
Look at his dad, Prez Maravich. My dad knew him also.
Oh, yeah?
I even met him
wow.
over time. I was watching that game with my dad on TV at the time.
Wow.
So we have a lot of history with, you know, going around the town with these basketball players. I have a lot of history there. And it's just amazing the techniques that his dad taught him. Some of the other guys that coach high school basketball were copying some of the things that his dad had taught him with ball control, hand and eye coordination. You know, and all these things sort of become standard where they do that with these other kids out there
wow.
to try to improve their game. And if there was a three-point shot for him, my goodness, he would have had 150 points a game.
And that's the truth.
No doubt about it. That's a great piece of history there, Jim. Where do you want to go next here? We got to talk coaching.
Let's wrap up the NFL season. You know,
right.
We had the Giants, you know, beat the Patriots again in the Super Bowl.
I got to interrupt. There's two guys that are winners right here. I must eat some crow.
Chip had them all the way from Green
rode
Bay,
that new,
man.
New York Giant.
Yeah.
Horse the know, whole way. I picked New England. I eat crow. My hat goes off to you guys. You pick the winner.
And you know, the Giants going into the playoffs, I believe that they were going to go a long way simply because they were playing the kind of football that can win championships. They were playing solid defense, ball control offense, and they were not turning the ball over. And that's not a very difficult formula to adhere to. Eli Manning raised the level of his game. He didn't make any mistakes. And, you know, if you've got your quarterback that's not blowing the game for you and your running backs aren't putting the ball on the ground, you're going to win a lot of football games. And, you know, my hat's off to the Giants. It was really quite a pleasure to watch the Patriots lose. And it's funny that the Patriots haven't won a Super Bowl since Spygate. And I find that kind of ironic, because now that you're not able to steal your opponent's signals, you know, they've become a team that can be beat.
You think you lose the edge that way?
A little bit of it, but, you know.
Well, let me ask you this. Have you guys ever met a Bradshaw that was smart? You know, when Terry Bradshaw played here, he couldn't spell cat if you spotted him the C and the T. And now Bradshaw, the running back, scores a touchdown when they told him to.
Oh, you know, time out, though. Yeah. Here's what I do. If I'm the coach or if I'm the quarterback that's yelling to stop, here's what I do. I don't hand him the ball. Because if you could yell to your running back not to do it, wouldn't you at least talk about this in the huddle that maybe they'll let you go?
But what I found interesting was Coughlin at the end of the game, you know, when he realized what was going on, he said, I hadn't thought about it at the time, but if I would have had a moment to think about that, I would have told him to score anyhow. Because, you know, if anybody watched what happened when the Ravens and the Patriots played, I mean, that was a gimme field goal, and it not so much. Right. Okay, sure, they were playing indoors, and the chances of him missing a field goal are minimal, but you know what? The way their defense was playing, I would have banked on the fact that they could stop them, and they did. You know,
those Bradshaws always go for the glory.
Yeah. Well, like I said, how hard is it to not score a touchdown when you see the goal line? I mean, that's what you're brought up to do.
The defensive players, they said, I don't know how not to tackle the ball carrier.
They stood up, and if you saw them, they were just standing with the other guys. Yeah.
Well, they learned that from the Green Bay Packers when they were upset the first time by John Elway in Denver. Mm-hmm. And it was quite embarrassed. But, you know, I took a lot of heat when a few years back when I talked about Spygate, and I talked about how criminal it was for Roger Goodell to have the evidence and destroy it and burn it because he claims there wasn't enough room for it in the NFL offices in New York. But if you think about it, everybody wants to, except for Chip, minimize Spygate. If stealing those signals was only worth 6 points per game, you subtract 6 points off of the three Super Bowl wins,
and they lost them all.
You give 6 points to the two Super Bowl losses, and they got 5 Super Bowl rings now.
Well, the biggest travesty of justice there was the fact that they fined Belichick $500,000, which, you know, it was like slapping him on the wrist, and you know Kraft paid that for him. Then they took a first-round draft pick from him, which they ended up, what did they do? They traded somebody and got the Raiders' first-round draft pick.
Right.
So it didn't matter, because they got 2 first-round draft picks. And it was laughable what they did to that team. So, you know, they treated it so, but it was real. And I thought it was kind of, I can't remember the exact words, but James Harrison and Ryan Clark tweeted after the game something about the fact that it was good to see the cheaters lose again. And, you know, that shouldn't be lost on anybody, because, you know, I'm a homer. I'll say that the Steelers could have potentially played in 2 more Super Bowls had it not been for the cheating that Belichick did.
And I wish Ryan Clark would have maybe been watching films to try to figure out how a free safety can get more than one interception a year.
Well, no comment on that. But getting back to the cheating, since you're talking about it. It's like in sports, we talked before. People are always looking for an edge. That is an edge. It's a legitimate edge, or why would you do it? Think about it. Don't they steal signs in baseball? They have guys that are stealing the signs if you can. That's why you see a manager, you see an assistant on third base or something giving fake signs. What do you see in college football?
But if everybody was doing it, then why was it such an issue? Because there wasn't any evidence that everybody else was doing it. You know, it was something that was unique to them. And you know, and I know everybody's looking for an edge, but You know,
no, I'm saying they shouldn't do that, and they should have gotten fined. They should have lost those trophies.
They should have, yes. Like, you know,
I think there's, and nobody should have got it.
And they got warned several times. It wasn't like the hammer came down. They were warned about doing those things several times. So they were notorious.
Well, you should lose the hardware. Yeah. That's all.
That was something that I'd always been really upset about, and the fact that it was just kind of, well, you know, this is one of the model franchises, so we're just going to brush this under the rug. You know, and, you know, you look at Sports Illustrated last week, and they've got, you know, Mr. Kraft on the front and how he's created the model franchise in the NFL. And it was funny because they were talking about the Pittsburgh Steelers doing that just last year. But, I mean, you got to give the guy credit. He has taken a team that was a hapless loser and made them into a consistent winner, you know, legitimately or, you know, by a hook or crook, but, you know.
When you have that doubt, when it puts that doubt on you, and I'm going to change gears like I usually do. Something happened with Lance Armstrong. They dropped the investigation. The Department of Justice dropped the investigation of Lance Armstrong and blood doping. Then the same day, the guy who won it last year.
Contador.
He's banned for 2 years. They caught him with the blood doping and everything else in the sport. So it just makes you wonder who has the money, who has the power, who's allowed to get away with this stuff. And that's why I'm bringing it up, because I've been an advocate that where there's smoke, there's fire. And I don't know it's true.
And I agree with you. And it's, and, you know, people like Lance Armstrong, you got Roger Clemens, Barry Bonds, and all these people that were involved with performance-enhancing drugs, blood doping or whatever, that, you know, they exhausted resources that most people couldn't, and it's never been proven that they didn't do what they did. They just gave up the lawsuits because they didn't want to continue sinking money into a money pit. I believe that where there's smoke, that there's fire.
Right.
And I think, you know, that, you know, you look what Marion Jones, you know, and I found something very ironic when she was interviewed recently. Yes, she admitted that she used steroids. She went and served her time in prison, and she admitted her crime. She did her time. But, you know, they asked her after the fact, they said, well, do you think you would have still won those gold medals had you not used the performance-enhancing drugs? And she said, oh, yes, I did. Well, then why did you use them? Okay, you know, if you thought you could have done it without using them, then why did you take that path? I mean, I just find that very ironic that you would say that.
I'll give you an insight. All these guys are wearing these necklaces and bracelets, and it's from this Phyten, Phyten company. There is no known physical enhancement having that. It's a placebo effect. Mm-hmm. And what that is these guys and girls need that. We've all played sports. We're all superstitious to a certain point. But this company's making millions of dollars. I can give you catalogs where there is silver, where there's copper, there's exotic different metals and things in it. This Phyten company, who's selling these to all these athletes, and they even are on commercials, there's no known properties that actually help your performance or anything about your physical body. But yet, they wear them in all these games. I mean, there's amazing stuff that's out there, and it's like follow the money. Mm-hmm. But athletes, like I said, being around it, being in horse racing, people look for an edge, whatever it may be. And it's a shame, because to me, I'd rather play you heads up, and if you're a better player, hey, I'm not going to like it, but you beat me. And that's how it should be.
Well, I believe if you're not cheating, you're not trying.
So. Well, you're a gladiator and a Coliseum type guy. So we know where you're coming from.
Well, to move on to the subject of the Pittsburgh Steelers and the hiring of Todd Haley.
Yeah, we want to get there.
And I found something very interesting in an article on Saturday where Joe Green was interviewed, and he was talking about why the change in the offensive coordinator or in the offensive philosophy of the team had to happen. And, you know, one of the things that wasn't happening under Bruce Arians is that, the Steelers were not effectively running the football. And, you know, when you think about that and you watch what the Giants did on Sunday, you know, they were able to run the ball, and they run the ball far less than they passed it, but they were able to get big enough chunks of yardage and control the clock that it actually opened up the passing lanes later on in the game for them to hit the big play when they needed it. You know, and I think one of the things that happened with the offense the last couple of years is you've got this home run hitter, Mike Wallace, out there that can run like lightning, and, you know, we keep on trying to get a big play every single series of downs. And, you know, people are defending against it. The defensive coordinators are going to say, okay, Wallace isn't catching a 60 or 70-yard touchdown pass against us this week. And then, you know, then you're second and 10, and you know, we're generally, because we don't have any blocking, it's second and 13, third and 14, and then, you know, you can't even run the ball. And you know, if the Steelers can get back to the way they've built that team is ball control offense, running the ball effectively, and you need to really want to get 4 or 5 yards every down. And you know, I'm going to give Todd Haley the benefit of the doubt. It'll be interesting to see what the change in coordinators does to this team, because I think they just got too comfortable with who they were, and maybe they do need a good kick in the butt.
With all the great offensive minds that are out here, experienced offensive personnel, why do you think the Steelers went with Todd Haley?
You know what? I don't have an answer to that, because I'm not privy to, you know, why they make decisions. I know that, you know what, the history of success that they've had, I will sit quiet and I will see what develops. You know, I don't have an answer as to why they did that.
I have
that.
A little theory.
Oh, sure.
On it.
Like,
here's the thing. Big Ben gets a little too big for his britches here.
Okay.
So I think that they're going to have this guy in here that's going to be yelling at him and in his face on a lot of things. And who knows how long that's going to last. Because all they wanted him to do, like I was saying last week, is tweak it before a young Jerry Jones comes into the game. But here's the other thing that you didn't know. The ambassador, Dan Rooney's coming back.
Mm-hmm.
He's retiring from that. So isn't that ironic that he's going to be back in town? And don't you think he'll provide a steadying influence on what's going on, and maybe he won't put up with a lot of the shenanigans that have gone on in this past year or so.
Shenanigans?
Well, like different things that happen, like players talking and doing all the tweeting and, you know, getting a little bit out of control there.
Well maybe he might, but see, here's the thing that they're inconsistent with. There's a lot of inconsistencies with the Pittsburgh Steelers, especially with Art Rooney II. And like I said, Art Rooney II's first love was law. He was a lawyer for 20 years, found out he was closer to Eddie Mason and Perry Mason, and now he wants to be the football guru. Listen, they keep saying they want to tweak Big Ben. Well, if you want to tweak Big Ben, why are you bringing in Todd Haley? Todd Haley is not a quarterback coach. Todd Haley, number one, has always been a wide receiver coach. He was wide receiver coach for Chicago, for the Jets. He was a wide receiver coach. Now, when he got elevated to coordinator with the Arizona Cardinals, that's name only, because Ken Whisenhunt called all the plays with the Arizona Cardinals.
Wow.
And you can't tell me that he was working with Kurt Warner when he's never worked with receivers. Now, he has helped out Larry Fitzgerald, but we can all coach Larry Fitzgerald. Now, when he went to Kansas City, he did a smart move. He hired Romeo Crennel, former head coach and a seasoned veteran, to run his defense. Offensively, he hired the fat guy, Charlie Weiss, who knows how to be a good offensive coordinator, terrible head coach. They went to the playoffs last year. Charlie Weiss couldn't get along with Todd Haley, which nobody can. So Todd Haley got rid of Charlie Weiss. Charlie Weiss went back to college. Haley took over the play calls this year for Kansas City, and they lost so many games, he got fired before the end of the season. So my question is, now Todd Haley never played high school football, never played college football. He was a golfer, a golf pro. So the only thing that he can do to help Ben is help him with his golf game.
So, I'm glad to see that Jim's giving him the benefit of the doubt.
I guess his free season Steeler tickets are gone. You're going to be able to go to Steeler headquarters now. I was worried about you the other night at the Super Bowl party there with your comments. You're not doing much better, my friend. But you do make some great points. I mean, he was a ball boy here also, so maybe through being around the team, he learned about that type of stuff, Jim. And I'm just being silly about it. That could be part of it.
It'll be interesting to see how things play out. You know, I mean, there's still a lot of roster moves that's got to be made. There's a number of holes that need to be filled. And, you know, there's a lot of needs that the Steelers have going into this upcoming season. You know, we've got a big question mark with, okay, you know, how effective is Rashard Mendenhall going to come back off that knee surgery? You know, you've got, you know, the defensive line that was decimated by injuries at the end of the year. We still don't have an offensive line. You know, there's some big decisions that need to be made. And, you know, I don't think that the hiring of the offensive coordinator at this point is the biggest issue they got. We'll see how it plays out.
And the only thing I can think, Chip, is, you know, the Steelers have never been a team to hire guys that young to be a coordinator because it's a transitional position. Todd Haley is going to get another head coaching position. I'm thinking that the Pittsburgh Steelers are liking this guy as their future head coach because if you look at it, whether you liked him or you hated him at Kansas City, he put together a heck of a staff. He put together one heck of a staff at Kansas City, and he ran things, and he was tough. I mean, this guy used to make his coaches, when they messed up, take a lap.
Then are you saying that he's similar to your main man,
I'd like to see Romeo Cannell make a lap.
Yeah,
make a lap.
He must never
make a water cooler.
Maybe that's why Charlie Weiss left.
He didn't know defense.
But if the Steelers liked this guy as a future head coach, don't forget, I've never seen a coach in the history of National Football League like Mike Tomlin, who came in, who got hired, was not allowed to bring in any of his assistants, had to keep all the assistants, had to keep the same exact system, and had to keep all the players. So, you know, that's never happened before. And I really think that Todd Haley could be being groomed because within 2 years, even if he does a good job as a coordinator, within 2 years he's going to get offered, even maybe next year,
somewhere
as
else.
A head coach.
Here's a rhetorical question, I guess. But do you look at Todd Haley in the way he 10-6 last year? Okay, with the Chiefs, he makes the playoffs. This year they got the team lined up; they're expecting a playoff run. You lose Jamaal Charles, who's probably a top five running back in the league. Mm-hmm. And very shortly after that, you lose your starting quarterback. Now, I know Matt Cassel's not the quarterback that's going to take you to a Super Bowl, but he's a manageable enough quarterback that won't lose a lot. I mean, they had so many devastating injuries. You know, maybe the reason why he lost his job, and I know he rubbed a lot of people wrong, but, I mean, he lost his team. He had a nice team going into the season, and the wheels fell completely off the bus. Now, you know, granted, Todd Haley can be a bit abrasive, and, he alienated his team, then he alienated his general manager, so, you know, there was, you know, he was the, you know, one common denominator. Everybody was pissed at him, so they had to make him go. But, you know, if he doesn't have those injuries and his team performed well, they'd put up with the fact that he was a bit on the obnoxious side.
And so, if you look at the hierarchy, the Steelers, their last three general managers, Dick Haley, Irish, Tom Donahoe, Irish, Kevin Colbert, Irish, Bill Cowher, head coach, Irish. It don't hurt that Todd Haley's Irish.
Irish like mobster type thing? I'm going to have to look back in the history books, but I have one point to disagree with history. I'm going to pull history on the Steelers. The three offensive coordinators that they pulled out from outside the organization, none of them survived more than a couple years. You had Joe Walton, Ray Sherman, and Kevin Gilbride.
Then you think, Kevin Gilbride has won two Super Bowls.
But that is elsewhere, so who knows?
I mean,
but none of them have had success here.
Now,
and they didn't move them up, so I'm holding
But Ron Earhart had great success here.
Well,
and he had great success with Neil O'Donnell as a quarterback.
Yeah,
you know, we saw what he did with his career.
That's a good point, though.
Interesting things out there.
But can we talk a little bit about the Hall of Fame class? I'm shocked DeMarty Dawson made it. Happy. I thought he should have been the first ballot Hall of Famer. But I always predicted that I didn't think DeMarty Dawson, even though well-deserved, would make the Hall of Fame because The reason was for Marty Dawson's last 2 years, he didn't play. He had a left hamstring injury that ended the season, and he had a right hamstring injury that ended the season. So I thought those 7 years that the revolving door of these sports writers who vote on the Hall of Fame, I didn't think that they would remember how great DeMonte Dawson was 7 years after he played.
I've been a big fan.
DeMonte Dawson was taught by the best. And yeah, his first year, he learned from Mike
Good
Webster.
Point. Good point.
And I had the opportunity to meet DeMonte Dawson back in 1990. And I actually took care of his lawn for him, for a company I worked for. And he was one of the nicest, most down-to-earth people, real class act.
Did he bake you some cookies?
No, he didn't bake me a cookie. He kept his Rottweiler from chewing my butt. But, you know... he was a very, very, he's a class act, and he is very deserving of the Hall of Fame. But I'll tell you what, the 7 years that he went to the Pro Bowl, there was no question that he was the best center in football.
I agree.
You know, and he was taught by the best, and he carried on the tradition that went from Mansfield to Webster to DeMonte Dawson, and, you know, and I was real happy to see him. Jack Butler, another man that, that was much very
Should
deserving.
Yeah.
You know, and I was happy to see him go.
Before you move on, is Jack Butler the youngest 85-year-old you ever want to see? Yeah. I couldn't believe it.
And
he's
I actually, here, I'll give you another. You know how I know a few people smoking, Jim? You're not going to believe this. So just
try to settle down now.
Now, this goes out to Bernie, his daughter, Hobart, and Tom, who were neighbors of mine in Baldwin for years. And working at the Post-Gazette, whenever there were articles, I could get them a Velox copy of the paper. So I did that for
what
him.
What kind of copy?
It's called Velux. It's like a nice, shiny type newspaper, but it's real thick, and you can actually get it framed.
Better than laminated.
Yeah, it's Velux. Yeah, and I'll have to show you a copy someday. But that's a shout out to them. Congratulations. And you can't beat that. They're really nice people, and they come from an athletic family also. Well, on both sides of the family.
Did you guys ever do work at the Post-Gazette?
Yes, we did. But we put a lot of hours in, so we have a lot of great conversations. I feel like you could come down, and matter of fact, since you said Post-Gazette, I want to thank all my friends and buddies and women that I worked with there for watching our show. And I was just at a funeral of a good friend of mine, is Jackie Clark Sr. had died, 84 years old. Good friend of mine, his son John and family. So who do I run into? The Post-Gazette people. And they said, we love your show.
Wow.
Chip, Mike, Smokin' Jim.
Oh, thanks.
They're watching the show now. My man Chief, he's watching the show. And then I run into friends of mine that I haven't seen in a while. They're getting our show in Upper St. Clair. I know it's not popular in Bethel to say Upper St. Clair, but Jim and Janet Hess, I thank you for your compliments on our show. And spread the word in the neighborhood. And these infomercials, since Mike's not here, maybe from his hospital bed, this will perk him up a little bit. And that's the end of the infomercial, unless I think of a few other people that we run into. But he is the youngest looking 85-year-old guy.
To get back to the Hall of Fame class, you know, Curtis Martin, elected to the Hall of Fame. He was the fourth leading rusher in the NFL when he finished his career. Chris Stolman, Pitt product, played a lot of years in the NFL. The thing I find kind of interesting, I always thought that Jerome Bettis and Curtis Martin would go in together. I thought that they were both worthy of being in the Hall of Fame. They did it over an extended period of time, and their statistics were fairly similar. I mean, they were then about 500 or 600 yards of one another rushing career-wise. And, you know, I was surprised that Curtis Martin went in before Jerome, because Jerome, you know, won a Super Bowl, and Curtis Martin never did get the chance. And, I'm just wondering how much longer Jerome is going to have to wait. I do believe that he is Hall of Fame worthy, and, he should get in. But the two omissions that kind of surprised me. And, you know, you look like, okay, Hines Ward got his 1,000th catch this year, okay? So he was the 8th player in NFL history to have 1,000 catches in his career. And there's two players that were ahead of him in catches, Chris Carter and Tim Brown, who are still waiting to get into the Hall of Fame. And Chris Carter, it's understandable why he's being snubbed, because not a lot of people liked him.
Right.
He upset a lot of sports writers, and, you know, now they are getting... and then the payback. But Tim Brown, you know, here's a kid who came out of Notre Dame, Heisman Trophy mm-hmm. winner, and he's one of the few Heisman Trophy winners that had an absolutely stellar right. NFL career. And I don't know what is keeping him. What did he more could he have done to make him Hall of Fame worthy? I think he should have been elected in his first year.
And another thing that Tim Brown, that's why I always say that I don't believe that Hines Ward is a slam dunk for the Hall of Fame. You know, I wouldn't vote for him. But Tim Brown, not only was he a great wide receiver, but he was one of the best punt returns and kickoff Good return point. Guys that ever played. So that was that's an added value for Tim Brown. And like I said, I thought that both Chris Carter, who only catches touchdowns, and Tim Brown, I thought they would both be first ballots because of the numbers. But
Maybe it's the team they play for.
Well, you know, it's a popularity contest with the sports writers.
But here's the two that I thought would get in. How Bill Parcells is not in the Hall of Fame, I don't understand that. Although he did tick off a lot of people in the media. But Eddie DeBartolo. Now, maybe being in the federal penitentiary hurt his chances a bit. But if you look at it, hey, in 20-some years with the San Francisco 49ers,
look what he did.
Four world championships.
Yep. And look how what an owner he was and how he treated the players.
16
the
straight
city.
Years of 10-game wins and better.
He should be in. He resurrected the Century Mall. Right.
he resurrected the 49ers franchise. Oh, yeah. In the late 70s, the early 80s. He injected a lot of excitement into the West Coast of the NFL.
Well, isn't his coach, Bill Walsh, in the Hall of Fame?
I believe he is.
Right? So, I mean, you would think that somebody that hired him and created that atmosphere for people to succeed there and spent the money on players. Look, they had two superstar Hall of Fame quarterbacks there at the same time.
Well, we're talking about, Parcells, being a Hall of Fame worthy, and I do believe that he should be, and I probably what may make it take a little bit longer for him is the fact that, he went from, the Giants to the, to the Patriots, to the Jets, to the Cowboys, and I think, if he would have stayed in one place. But one of the things at the end of the Super Bowl that I saw that really kind of, as much as we talk about Spygate and Bill Belichick and all that, but he did a very classy move at the end of the game, if you noticed. He went over and he did not shake Tom Coughlin's hand. Those two embraced and hugged and patted each other on the back. And those two were members of Bill Parcells' staff when he won two Super Bowls in New York. And I just thought that was a very classy thing for him to do, Belichick, because those two were comrades in arms for a long time. And you know what? Both teams played their heart out. And, on Sunday, the Giants were a better team than the Patriots. And it was good to see that he, recognized that.
We got to see if they do it again, because don't forget they were, they knew each other the first Super Bowl, and Belichick never made his way over there to shake his hand. But I agree. The one thing about Curtis Martin is, number one, the yardage, 14,000. I always thought that him and Jerome Bettis, 13,000 yards for Bettis, would be slam dunk first ballots. But you look at Curtis Martin, and I tell you what, I'm very familiar with Curtis. Curtis Martin didn't play football until his senior year in high school at Taylor Allardyce, where he ran for 2,000 yards. I was at the playoff game when he went against Notre Dame great Ray Zellers for Oliver in the playoffs. Oliver beat them. But
who did you recommend that he go to when you scouted him?
Well, with Curtis Martin?
Yeah.
He was very fast in high school, but a little bit surprised that, you're always surprised when a kid is being recruited. But he was not that highly recruited, although Pitt did offer him a scholarship. But thing is, I like about Curtis Martin is, one, he's a very religious guy. I got good taste in women, Tony Braxton, for a while there. But the thing that I like is he's so humble when he gives back. The guy that's going to present him as Bill Parcells, he says he would not have played more than 3 or 4 years if it wasn't for Bill Parcells being his mentor, having his back. Because when Curtis Martin, don't forget that Johnny Majors was the head coach of Pitt. Mm-hmm. Curtis Martin got hurt his junior year. He ran for 250 yards, 275 yards or something against Texas, and then was out for the rest of the year and wanted to come back and play at the end of the year, but they wanted to redshirt him to have him back the next year. But he went and turned pro, and everybody thought he was crazy. And Parcells drafted him in third round, and the rest is history. So he could have really been like Curvin Richards or somebody like that, that really didn't have much of a career in the NFL.
Well, you know, and Curtis Martin did carry himself as a true professional. I mean, you know, you see these guys with the degree of success that he had, you know, you would have never known. You know, he wasn't out there mugging for the camera, trying to make the highlights on SportsCenter or anything like that. He just came in every day, did his job, worked hard, and he was one of the best backs of his era.
He grew up running away from muggers.
It was a shame he didn't come home to Pittsburgh. Yeah. Can you imagine him playing here, what he would have had? Because we were running then, too.
Now, were you guys surprised that Chris Dolman made it? I always thought he had Hall of Fame numbers, but I was kind of surprised that Chris Dolman made it over
I was surprised about him, but I was really more surprised by the omission. I just don't understand how Tim Brown does not get into the Hall of Fame. And he never, you know, brought a lot of attention to himself. But when you look at his numbers, I mean, what more does a player have to do to make it into the Hall of Fame? And I wish I knew what the criteria was that they used to say this person is Hall of Fame worthy and this person is not. It would be interesting to find out.
Mike back here to tell us about how sports writers are.
Right.
Because he'll give you the criteria they don't have it. It's like whose pocket they're in or what team they're for. If you're not playing for the right team in the right city.
Why isn't Kevin Green in?
That's another guy that I wonder. Kevin Green should be there. And my sister Hope, my biggest fan,
keep
will tell
Hope
you.
Alive.
Kevin Green should be in there. She'll tell you that much. So
I agree with Hope as usual.
Probably,
you know, what tarnished Kevin Green to a degree is that he played in an era where there was a lot of great linebackers playing, you know, and he was just one of many. He played his heart out when he was here, and he was an impact player everywhere he went.
Well, he was better than Ricky Jackson. Kevin Green's the all-time leading sacker in NFL history for linebackers. Only two guys got more sacks than him is Reggie White and Bruce Smith, two defensive ends. Kevin Green played on the opposite side. He played on the hardest side to get a sack over there where Woodley is playing. He had the same hump move that Reggie White has. I just don't understand that they don't like Kevin Green because he could not be blocked.
Well, those are some of the things with the Hall of Fame that, you know, we just don't understand. But where else do you want to go? What sports have we missed here?
Well, actually, why didn't we touch base with the Penguins?
Yeah.
The Penguins are still resurgent. And, I brought up a point last week, you know, when I, you know, talking about the number of games that Marc-Andre Fleury had played and how, you know, I think that, you know, we should, think about giving him a rest. And there was a perfect example of that. We played back-to-back games Saturday and Sunday. We played in Boston Garden and the Penguins played their hearts out. They won 2-1. Great game on Saturday. It was a great victory. Yeah. And then, you know, they
against the world champs.
Yeah, against the Stanley world champs. Cup. And then, you know, they go to New Jersey and they put Fleury in again in the first period on the first 12 shots he faced. He gives up 3 goals. They pull Fleury. Brent Johnson basically gives up 2 goals, but the game ended up being 5-2. And maybe the Penguins would have been better served to sit Marc-Andre down because he's been playing so many games. And we're going to need him more as the season goes on and going into the playoffs. And I don't want them to ride this horse, and wear him out when we're going to need him the most.
When you brought it up last week, I was thinking of you during the game because you were like a prophet on that.
Sometimes you get lucky.
Okay, well, you got lucky on that.
I don't want to get too full of myself here, okay?
Okay. We still got a little room. They can adjust the camera. There's still some headspace.
The Giants, he may be a problem.
I know. Yeah. I'm getting a little nervous here, but I thought about him.
I'm not getting rich.
He's sitting on
it.
Tebow's book.
He didn't give the Tebow pose. So. And I'll go on off subject.
And I won't. And I won't. It's not going to happen anytime soon.
You have more respect than most of these other people taking the cheap throw on different advertisements and awards.
No, but I think, you know,
you were right on that.
The Penguins are playing the Canadiens tonight, and I'd like to see them You know,
I didn't get a score yet up there.
Yeah, well, they start at 7:38, so okay. I mean, they probably haven't dropped the puck just yet.
Hope and Gary,
or they're getting close to.
Give us an update, Hope and Gary. Right.
But you know, but I really think that, you know, for the Penguins to go deep into the playoffs, which we all expect they will, I do think they have the team around them that can do that. They've been playing good team defense. You know, they've got enough offensive weapons. Stahl's going to be coming back here. They said 5 to 10 days, and he'll be back in
maybe
the lineup.
Maybe even sooner. He said he's
you know,
almost ready.
And you know, and I hate to bring up it up, but you know, we do expect a certain somebody who will remain nameless to come back at some point.
March.
But even if he doesn't, you know, I still think that they've got a team that could do this. But I think the whole linchpin to that is Marc-Andre Fleury, and you know, I just don't want to see them burn him out before they really need him.
Well, you have to at least mention Malkin.
Oh, you
did forget about him.
I didn't know.
All right, Prophet, you have to mention him.
Evgeny has been playing lights out. And I think he's going to be, you know, the Hart Trophy, I think, you know, could possibly be, you know, for his to take this year and the Art Ross. I mean, there's no question. He's playing head and shoulders above anybody else in the league right now.
Score update, 0-0, 3 minutes in the game.
There you go.
Wow. Biggest fan just texted in here.
Thanks, Hope.
But I did want to tell you that with Malkin and these players and with Stahl coming back, he could be back in the next couple of days now. I heard an interview where he said physically he's ready, but mentally he's a little worried about taking a hit.
Who's that?
Right now, Jordan Stahl. Just because of the knee injury on the ice, I can't even imagine skating, yet look at how these guys perform on there. And to have a knee injury like these guys have, and even Tyler Kennedy supposedly has a lower body injury too, so you know that hurts. But we are getting all the pieces starting to come back, and you know I'm hopeful they do have one of the best teams. And look what they did with Boston. That showed me what they can do without the guy we're not going to put the spotlight on. Let him come back when he's ready.
Yeah, you know, he gave up those three, you know, goals in the first few minutes against New Jersey, and then they went back and played a great game. I mean, you know, they played them even up. You know, they keep the games at, you know, 2-3 goals, and they're going to win more than their share of them.
Well, that's why I give Bausma a lot of credit with his coaching. He has that system in the defense. He plugs these minor leaguers. They come in and out, and now they got another player, O'Reilly, that they have here that maybe he can be a playmaker too. So, you know, they did add a little bit. And I don't think they have to go out for a superstar player like some of these rumors are going around.
Well, you know, and they just don't have the cap room. I was listening on the way over to the radio, and the Penguins only have about $2 million of wiggle room with the cap right now. So, you know, if they do try to pick up somebody, they're going to have to, you know, assume part of that contract, and they need to the finances are going to play into it, because, you know, we've got that, you know, that nameless player and his contract, you know, on our salary cap right now. You know, we do expect him back, but, you know, you're wondering at this point, you know, should they put him on injured reserve and use that money and that space to bring in other people? Or, you know, is it realistic that we could expect to see him play this year? You know, we'll just have to wait and see.
Well, when are they going to unveil the statue?
That's coming up, I thought, in March. So that maybe that's when it'll happen. It'll all come together there. You just never know. And that cap talk, they were even on that same show, I think I was listening to it too. They said maybe getting rid of Martin and his $5 million contract would help with the cap. So, I mean, people get really crazy with caps. We didn't even mention the Steeler cap, which I've been harping on the last couple shows, and they have to get under that too. So.
And they'll find a way somehow. You know, I mean, you figure out, you know, the number of people that are going to end up not being here next year. You know, you've got Aaron Smith, you know, Chris Hoch retired. I don't see Aaron Smith making it back. I mean, the guy's, you know, had a tremendous career, great defensive lineman, great teammate. Just had so many season-ending injuries in the last, like, 3 years, and he's not getting any younger. You know, they could, you know, the money that they pay him, they could probably pick up a couple of younger guys that might make more of an impact than last the season.
And one of the greatest defensive players I've ever seen in college at Northern Colorado was Aaron Smith. He had 50 sacks coming out of college. Unbelievable body lean, He was just a great steal for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
I mean, you know,
sometimes age catches up with
him. And I don't mean this in a bad way. I mean, he, you know, I just think his body, his mind is willing, his heart is willing, and I think his body's just, you know, breaking down on him.
Since you're talking about bodies and things like that, what about Casey Hampton with his ACL and the shape he normally comes to camp?
Wow.
To rehab, that's a pretty severe injury, an ACL. Now, he doesn't have to run that much. But still, you have to be able to stand up and support all that weight. And he's been, you know, super in the
middle.
It must
be in his contract that he don't have to run.
Well, run much. They did make him run a couple
times.
He can
tie up two offensive linemen all day long. 200-300 pounders, he can sit there and fight.
But do you guys think he'll be able to come back?
But he sure don't come in camp in shape at all.
Right. But will he be able to come back from an
ACL? That's going to be tough. He's really going to have to rehab.
There's a lot of questions for the Steelers this year, and you know, you think about what do you think the Steelers ought to do when it comes draft day, and there's just so many different things. You know, I think that definitely they have to go offensive line, but I think they should go a running back high in the draft, because if they want to get back to, you know, emphasizing the run, you know, Rashard Mendenhall has been good, but you know, running backs in the NFL don't last a long time, and you know, you have these knee injuries and. You know, do you come back at 100% of what you were? You know, only time will tell that, but, you know, you need to get some younger, fresh legs in. You know, I know you got Ike Redman, and he's been doing well, but I think, you know, they need to, you know, get some more horses in that backfield. You know, if that's, you know, they've got the studs on the wides, you know, the wides right now. They've got a franchise quarterback, and I think they need to, you know, the center there, they need to get offensive linemen, and to be able to run, you got to have offensive linemen that are aggressive run blockers, and it doesn't seem like, you know, they've had that knack. I mean, Chris Kimuatu last, you know, at one point I remember Mike Tomlin saying that he was a violent run blocker, and not so much lately, you know. And
he got some nice penalties for the other teams.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, you know, you have to be able to push people back, and I just didn't see him doing that a lot this year. Basically, played his way out of the lineup.
And what do you think, Scout?
I think the Steelers. I think the Steelers should bring home Lasaka Polite and have a fullback. You got to get a fullback in there, like Chip said. Like to get another running back in the draft at some point. But you know, speaking of drafting and recruiting, who had the better recruiting class, Pitt, Penn State, or Robert Morris in football?
I'm
sure you're already asking the question because you know the answer.
What about West Virginia? I heard they had a decent.
Well, a very decent, but it looked like you know, Pitt and Penn State. You know, this recruiting class won't go down in history like the '83 draft.
Didn't Penn State lose like 3 recruits to Ohio State?
Well, you know that
at least, right?
Coach from Ohio State's making everybody mad because he's getting everybody's players. So
he's back and he wants to win.
Yeah,
you can't beat that.
Yeah, trying to find him another Tebow somewhere.
He's looking
before his heart goes out again.
But what do you think about offensive linemen? Are they out there in the draft, or should we wait for second, third, fourth, fifth rounds, or free agents?
Well, my philosophy has always been that if you look at the defensive line. That the garbage defensive line that the colleges have been filling the NFL with. I mean, these guys are mostly tweeners, 250-pound defensive ends, 270-pound defensive tackles. So your offensive linemen should dominate the defensive line because for the most part, these guys are undersized. So my philosophy has always been, why get some chubby kid from college when you can get an established veteran that's already playing in the National Football League. We can get two guys. We already have Pouncey. If you can get Pouncey healthy, you already got somebody there. We're stuck with Gilbert for another couple of years. So get two more players, veterans, and free agencies like Chip says. You're freeing up the salary cap with some of the grizzled veterans that had to retire. So now you can use that money to plug in. Who was the guy we got from Dallas a couple years ago?
Hozel
came in and did a great job, and he was towards the end of his career. At the very
end. How about
end.
My man Max Starks? You get him for the last 3 months of the season. It protected Big Ben, and Big Ben and him like each other.
I like to get a Pro Bowl. Okay. I tell you what, you talk about centers for the Pittsburgh Steelers has been great. But I tell you what, a guy that I love that nobody talks about is Harding.
And Jeff Harding.
Jeff Harding was an outstanding center, a guy who was an all-pro guard for the Detroit Lions. They brought him in. So those are the type. Give me a guy who's already established Pro Bowler. People want to come and play with the Steeler Nation. So use that. Bring the offensive line here. We should have the best. Every year we should have the greatest offensive line in football, because those guys are blue-collar people, and they want to come and play for a no-nonsense organization like the Pittsburgh Steelers. Quit being cheap and bring those guys in.
And I agree that they should do that short-term. And in long-term, I think if there's any position on the field where you can find talent that can be developed is on the offensive line in the later rounds of the draft, and you don't have to waste high draft picks
on
players. You know, I mean, how many offensive linemen in the NFL were fourth, fifth round draft picks? You know, they come in, they learn the system a year or two, and then they're able to, they strengthen up, they learn their technique, and then they're able to be contributors. And in the short term, you know, you have the veterans to teach them how to play the position.
And that's a good point. And other than Russ Grimm, who I think is the greatest offensive line coach ever, next to Joe Moore, that was a great college offensive line coach, who was Russ Grimm's offensive line coach. I think Kugler's a heck of an offensive line coach. So now we got a guy in that can coach some of these young offensive
You need the players, like you're saying, and they're out there. It's just we have to get them in here under the cap, get rid of some of these other guys.
And I'd give up 2 first-round draft choices if the Steelers can get a strength coach in here. We ain't have a strength coach.
Excuse me, did you say 2 first-round?
Yeah, I give up 2 first-round. We can get a good. We ain't had a good strength coach in years.
Are you asking for a job or something? Are you trying to promote yourself here? I see some self-promotion here. I recognize that type of conversation. You know that.
Because, you know, you remember back in the day when we had Cowboy Cole and Mike Webster and all those guys rolling up their sleeves, Steve Corson. We had the strongest guys in the NFL on the offensive line. That's because we had superior strength coach. Bring in a strength coach. Get these guys to start looking like they're the next Mr.
You
Universe.
Actually bring up about Kolb and all these guys. Well, there was a place called Karinga's Restaurant in Washington, PA, right near the Meadows.
Where Jerry Sandusky's from.
No. Oh. We don't know Jerry Sandusky at this point. Hopefully he's innocent, but that's the law. It doesn't look or sound that way. But they used to work out in a weight room right below the restaurant there, and you could see these guys working out then.
Wow.
And they threw a lot of weights around. So you're right
about
the
NFL used to have
ethic.
Back in the day, if you watch the classic sports, NFL had the strongest man contest. Yeah. And out of the top 5 strongest guys in the NFL, 4 was from the Steelers every year.
John Kolb was winning that award every year.
Yeah,
John Kolb was winning that award.
The work ethic, too. That's the thing. They had that work ethic where they do it. Now they work out all year long. But you don't hear these guys being that strong.
And see, this is what a strength coach can do. We had a great blocking tight end called Larry Brown.
Right.
They strength coach got him,
became
put 30 pounds
tackle.
On him, tight all end, muscle, and he ended up being an all-pro tackle.
Yes.
Yeah, great thing,
Yes, he did. That was a great transformation there.
That gives us some hope with the offensive line. If we can straighten that out, keep Big Ben healthy, get the receivers to catch the ball a little bit, get a fullback, which maybe we'll have a fullback like you say. So we'll see what happens.
The Steelers have their work cut out for them, but you know, at the end of the day, you know, we're going to be competing for the division crown again next year, I believe.
And don't forget about Pitt. We'll talk about them after they win Wednesday night and maybe win another game before our next show. So then we'll see if they'll be NCAA eligible. And I want to thank everybody for watching our show. Don't forget, you can contact us at PittsburghSportsLine@gmail.com. You can call in 412-831-3304 if you like the conversation. Thanks to Chip Hayner, Smokin' Jim Frazier, and Magic Mike Migliori. Get well soon. This is Al Levine, the Talking Machine. See you next week, folks. We'll be right back.
And now, another adventure with Savings Man.
Oh, dear. I can't afford that.
Charge it. You can pay it off later.
Not so fast, credit card guy.
Savings Man.
Don't let him entice you, ma'am. Credit card guy can lead you to big trouble. You need a savings plan.
You're right, Savings Man.
Get this ballpark estimate worksheet at choosetosave.org. It will help you get started.
Gee, thanks, Savings Man.
No, thank you.
So visit choosetosave.org and get your ballpark estimate today.
Check to see if your dad or someone you love qualifies for extra help with Medicare drug costs by going to socialsecurity.gov.
Thanks, Patty. I don't see Gidget doing that for her dad.